All right, very great. Just a continuing updating of the I am everywhere right nowness. I am everywhere right now, right nowness. That is identity. That is I am everywhere right nowness. Everywhere right nowness. The backlash that I've gotten from this is unprecedented. So it takes an effort of will to remain positive and keep on affirming this in the face of just this incredible backlash. That which insists upon defining what we are as something that can be perceived is fanatically opposed to this, fanatically opposed to this. Is everywhereness actually perceiving something? Is it really perception, or is it pure awareness? So this statement, "I am everywhere right nowness." I am the feeling of everywhere right nowness. This is the feeling that I am. This is the most powerful mantra, a statement, declaration. But it certainly dredges up fanatical resistance. Cursing, you know, I feel like there's this resistance that is like saying, if you accept this, you're going to be cursed forever. I'm going to curse you forever and ever and ever and ever and ever. You know, just that which wants to believe that perception is greater than awareness. Perception is greater than reality. It's fanatically opposed to this. But so do have to remain patient in the mood of repentance. Use a will and determination to stay positive. I've had a rough go of it here, for sure. Try not to entertain. I actually entertained some scenarios like a courtroom drama where these combatants were, you know, arguing and hissing at each other. It's very unusual for me to do that. So there's this intense struggle going on. I am everywhere nowness. Everywhere nowness. I am everywhere nowness. And it's difficult to think about this, difficult to explain it, difficult to think about it, but there's an intuitive recognition that this is so. It goes beyond words, this issue. I am everywhere nowness. And nothing else other than that. I am everywhere nowness and nothing else other than that. So this is on the level of will and determination and repentance here to say this, because there's again tremendous resistance and backlash to say no, you can't do that, you cannot feel that. So There is a phase here I'm just discovering of this backlash where you just have to stand your ground, in spite of this inner feeling that you're being vilified and cursed forever to even dare to entertain this. Try not to get into a verbal battle at all. Just don't let those thoughts arise, don't let any fantasies arise of a battle. Just notice that there's this disquiet. Don't try to explain it. Don't try to explain it at this point. Now, I'm aware that it is possible to explain it clearly, but not right now, because this is when the backlash is happening. So you have to be smart when you feel this resistance at its at peak resistance. Just don't cave into it. So I'm not going to collapse. No, I am everywhere nowness. Period. That's it, and nothing else. I am everywhere nowness and nothing else. And that's how it's going to be. Forever and ever. Don't personify the resistance. Don't give it a voice, a face, a form. Just be patient and humble and non-reactive. So this training in the mood of repentance is essential to be able to handle the backlash of something like this. Eventually we have to get to the point where we're able to assert the truth. And there is this nails on a chalkboard backlash. So again, the discipline of the mood of repentance is all important to be able to handle the great good news. But the great good news, of course, you realize, wow, all this time I wasn't aware of this. I wasn't aware of awareness, as it were. I was rejecting awareness in favor of perception of form. And there's a shock, definitely a shock taking place. I am everywhere nowness. I am everywhere nowness. Everywhere nowness. The feeling I am is everywhere nowness. Which is always the case. Always the case. But as soon as we think about it, or try to perceive it, or conceptualize it, the feeling is not there. Thoughts are reactions to our perceptions. And when we're perceiving, we do not perceive everywhere nowness. In fact, we only perceive what is just immediately surrounding us. We can only imagine the rest, and it's all fuzzy and incoherent. Perception is like an extreme blindness, actually. An extreme blindness. So, of course, as we're coming out of this extreme blindness, we're going to have a continuity fear, and that continuity fear will feel like a backlash. As we lose our grip on the familiar, the belief in perception is our identity. Then we're going to feel this jitters of continuity jitters, which I'm certainly feeling now to an extreme extent, and have been to this day. It's been quite a ride, rough ride. Well, I told the Holy Spirit to shorten my spiritual path much as possible, and then it came up, I am everywhere nowness. Just say that. Well, so I feel like my path has been shortened to an extreme extent. And so that itself is shocking. It's like, wow. I just leapt, took this huge leap, you know, it's just, oh. when we're feeling everywhere nowness, what need do we have it to define, to perceive? We're already getting the pure fact. We're feeling the pure fact that everything right now, everywhereness, everywhere right nowness is a fact. Universal fact, that universe of universal facts is this right nowness. Everywhere right nowness is what is present. You see, you hear some kids playing at the park. You say, okay, I'm here. Oh, I hear them kids at the park. Okay, there's a sense of distance, a sense of time. You don't feel that there's an everywhere right nowness to perception, ever. Ever, that feeling does not arise from perception. So everything is where it is right now. Everything is where it is right now. Everywhere is right now. Everywhere right nowness. Independent of any perception from any location, you see. Doesn't matter. What's more important than any explanation is the process of handling the backlash of this. Anyone can say this and affirm it and intuit it, but then the backlash comes. That's the tough part. 1 minute. So what's important here is to be assured that it's possible to handle the backlash. Don't argue, don't dispute, don't engage, just remain calm, muted, subdued, non-argumentative, non-reactive. I am everywhere nowness. I am the feeling of everywhere nowness. I am the feeling of everywhere nowness. This dredges up everything. Just dredges up the entire complex of resistance. No question about it. I have this song playing in my mind. Well, I told you if you walked out on me, we were through. And in other words, if you walk out on definition, perception, we're through. You know, perception says, we are through. Well, absolutely we are through. So it's trying to threaten, hey, don't you dare walk out on definition, perceptual definition of life, of how we're supposed to feel. We'll never get back together again. Well, that's true. That is absolutely true. Never get back together with perception as identity. No. But identity doesn't need to be perceived. See? Happiness doesn't need to be perceived. Reality doesn't need to be perceived. Oneness does not need to be perceived. So there's no need for perception. There's no use for perception. We don't need perception. So what I believe is happening is this prayer for had have my path shortened as much as possible. Oh, good. I've been looking for that cat. The cat showed up. Good. I thought, ha, great. That has worked. That has worked. This has worked. I need to speed everything up now. The fourth dimensional war against this planet is underway. It is underway. It's been underway for quite some time, but it's going to become more and more and more and more evident. More and more evident. And they don't play fair at all. You see, there's a difference. It's an ideological war at its root. It's a war of demanding perception and worshiping form and worshiping forms of perception. Worshiping specialness, so we feel that the fourth dimensionals are special, you see. So they feel welcome here, they feel secure that, oh, people will look up to us and worship us and say that we're special. And there's this massive pressure going on right now. And things, the war could actually break out any time right now. This upcoming World Cup in Brazil, I believe, is very significant. Brazil has some very central role to play in everything that's taking place here in the world. So this ideological war is raging right now, raging. Just like the wildfires in San Diego. I just noticed a brief blurb about those. I haven't seen any of it. I try not to pay any attention to the news. I certainly don't try not to watch anything that's taking place. I don't pay any attention to it because that fixates our perception on something, and we get out of touch with I am everywhere nowness, which is our true identity. That's how we feel. That's our experience of identity, is I am everywhere nowness. I am everywhere nowness. And so there's part of us who are saying, how dare you walk out on me like that? You know, perceptual definition saying, how dare you walk out on me like that? You don't dare, I'll curse you forever. That's what the feeling is. Have to remain firm. I am everywhere nowness. I am everywhere nowness. I accept this. This is totally acceptable. I am everywhere nowness is totally acceptable to me. It's totally acceptable. What I am does not need to be perceived. What I am is everywhere nowness. Every moment, everywhere nowness. That is the condition of reality. See, when perception, we think that stuff that's close to us is more present than stuff that's farther away from us, present in the moment. And we can't help but conclude that stuff that's farther away from our perception is less real, less present than stuff that's closer to us. But in fact, everything is equally present, everywhere nowness, equally present in this very moment. Everything is equally present in this very moment. But our perception cannot give us that feeling. It's impossible. It's independent of any location, perceptual location. Because any perceptual location will automatically have this closer and farther awayness, this duality, this relativity. So I am everywhere nowness is the totally non-relative, non-dual feeling. Now we think of individuality as based on perceptual definition of our thinking reacting to our perception. So we think, well, I am this body is right here, and these things are farther away. The question is to be the identity. So we say the body's real, it's the identity, and then other stuff is accoutrements, the ornaments of the identity, the body, the perceiving apparatus mechanism. And stuff that's farther away is less relevant, less present to the location of the perception. But everywhere nowness doesn't have a particular location of perception to it. So everything is equally present in the moment, in the nowness, everywhere nowness. And so we don't have an identity of the body is the identity, that the perceiving mechanism is the real identity, and other stuff is less real. There's a feeling of everything being equally real. It's only reality, only presence in the moment. Everywhere nowness, feeling of everywhere nowness, which perception just simply can't give to us. So we're like just utterly blind and unable to feel. Perception cannot give us the feeling that we really want. Not at all. Not even remotely so. Inherently not so. And our thinking tries to compensate for this. Our conceptualizing, our thinking. We try to make the body more important. We say, well, if I just make the perceiving mechanism more important, then I'll feel better. So let me dress it better. Let me, you know, make it seem better and more important, and have more important things around it, so I can look at all these things around and say, "Oh yeah." Of course, then stuff further out there is—it's like nothing. It's nothing. It's nothing. So everywhere nowness is a feeling. It's not a perception. It's a feeling. It's not like we are perceiving everything. It's a feeling of like total stability, total presence. Difficult to describe exactly, but everything is everywhere nowness. Everywhere nowness is aware of everywhere nowness. Everywhere nowness is everywhere nowness. But it's not the individual things that's important, it's the everywhere nowness that's important. It's like awareness is aware. Awareness is aware. Not perceptual awareness, but more like pure spaciousness awareness. The awareness that is pure spaciousness. Everything is equally present right now. Everywhere nowness. Everything is equally abiding in pure spaciousness right now. It doesn't matter what the relative location of anything is at all. That's totally irrelevant to the feeling, to this feeling of total supportiveness, total oneness. So this is certainly dredging up enormous resistance, and which is good. That's great. That's the whole point of it. So the path is one in which you do dredge up resistance and then let it dissipate, let it evaporate. But don't engage with it. Don't engage with it. Just let it evaporate. I am the everywhere nowness. That is my identity. I am the everywhere nowness. That is my identity. It's not this body. That's not my identity. It's not these things, these plants, these trees. It's not any of that. It's not anything. It's the everywhere nowness that is my identity. That is identity, actually. Not just my identity. It is identity. It's true identity. It's the identity of truth. Truth is identity. A piece of dust, other side of the world, is just as much fully present right now as this body is sitting here, other side of the world. Same, as far as the presence goes, right? It's not a perceptual question. A leaf, thousands of miles from here, sitting on the side of a dirt road somewhere. That's equally true. That leaf is present, sitting on the side of the dirt road, as it is this book that's sitting on the table right now. Right now, this book on the table and that leaf on the dirt road are equally present in the moment, right to this moment, this very instant. So there's just this presence, this one presence, feeling of presence, totally stable presence. There's nothing out of whack with this presence, is there? Nothing out of place. Nothing not present. There's nothing not present this very moment. And when we think about it, we start thinking is a type of perception. We're thinking, okay, now from what perspective, from what angle, from where's the what are you seeing that from? No, it's a fact, a felt fact. So the entire perceptual definition identity complex is right now crumbling in me. It seems to be crumbling, and it's cursing me as it crumbles. How dare you crumble this, you know? Well, I'm the one that raised it up in the first place, so, and sustained it through projection. So I have every right to, you know, stop projecting all this, you know, silliness. But we certainly projected a very feisty lawyer, as it were, that's litigating this and insisting that you don't walk out on it. But that's our own lawyer that we have trained to be so feisty and to threaten us and curse us and all this. And so you say, hey, I did a good job, great acting. I'm giving an Oscar to the lawyer. We're just trying to scare ourselves into remaining in this nightmarish, blind state of feeling isolated. Somehow isolated. There's no isolation from presence, is there? Everywhere nowness is anything isolated or in such a situation? Isn't the sun? In the sky, this sun and a star a billion light years away, whatever. Aren't they both equally present in this moment? Isn't their presence equally, right now in this moment, equally present? Isn't everything equally present in this moment? Isn't all appearances and non-appearances equally present in this moment? All appearances and all non-appearances are equally present in this moment. Everywhere. In other words, all appearance and non-appearance, everywhereness, everywhere nowness, everywhere right nowness. How could it not be so? Only by claiming that there's some perceiver, some form-based perceiver, some perception from some location that is somehow viewing this from the standpoint of the perception where they are, that is the starting point, as it were, only from that craziness of a perceptual identity can we not be aware of the obvious fact of the situation. A fly on somebody's nose right now is equally present as a meteor, an asteroid flying through the, you know, the solar system somewhere, this very moment. The presence is equal, the same presence, it's present in the moment, this very moment, right now. Or everything has a, all appearance has a location right now. So that the location right now-ness, right? That's a fact, isn't it? And it's all appearing right now. This appearance is as it is right now. All appearances are as they are. This very instant, equally so. Glass bottle here, a car over in New York, a wave in the Indian Ocean. It's all happening simultaneously, this very moment. The presence of all of those is equally present to the moment. Equally present to the moment, right? Equally present to the moment. All the birds settling down for the evening here are equally present to the moment of all the birds waking up halfway around the world right now. It's dusk here and it's dawn somewhere else. Birds are waking up, so the birds that are waking up, the birds that are settling down, this right now, equally present to right now. Perceptually, we say, no, I see these birds here. Birds are half on the other side of the world waking up. I can't, they're not equally present to this body, see? They're farther away from the perceiver. That's why they say, the gurus say, no teacher, no student, no teaching. No teacher, no student, no teaching. That Punjaji said, that's what he said. They asked, can you please wrap in a nutshell, can you please just say what your teaching is? There's no teacher, no teaching, no teacher, no student, no teaching. No perceiver of the moment, just the moment. The moment doesn't need to be perceived for everything, all appearances to be as they are, present to the moment, in the moment, present in the total pure spaciousness, the zero dimensionality of the moment. Now, it's important, it's like slogging through heavy mud or snow or something right now. The backlash is you know, there. It's like, wow. But you just have to accept it and say, okay, it's fine. Backlash is there. Doesn't mean it's not right. That doesn't mean I'm not getting it. No, it's just that when you're dusting something, a lot of dust is gonna maybe come up, or and then you get relationships, special relationships, which are just two perceptual locations saying, agreeing that they're together now, and say, look, wow, see, we're the center of the universe. Everything out from us is more and more distant, more and more distant. But at least I found something that is here now, you know, that type of thing. Special relationships. Whereas everywhere now is there's no specialness at all, right? Total absence. The specialness-free moment. Specialness-free moment. Everything as it is totally specialness free. Everything as it is totally specialness free. This moment as it is totally free of all specialness. This moment as it is totally free of all specialness. So these are the practices that I've been giving out in so many videos. All relate to this everywhere nowness feeling. The everywhere nowness feeling, everywhere right nowness, everywhere right nowness, everything just as it is, meaning everywhere right nowness. It's not that almost everything is present right now. The appearance of everything is present right now, and there's some other appearances which are just a little bit late. And not quite present right now. That's impossible. It's absolute everywhere right nowness. And this is something that is like, it's just dawning on us. What we're really doing is awakening up from a coma of severe blindness, craziness, total deprivation, incredible deprivation. So this we're feeling like, wow, sort of stunned by the wake up. So there's absolute richness every instant, everything both manifest and unmanifest. Is everywhere right nowness. The unmanifest is all right now, right? Everything that's not manifest, isn't that a fact right now? It's not manifest as an appearance. That's right now too. Everything you're not doing is also present right now. Satisfact, everything is present right now, both the doing and the not doing, the appearing and the not appearing. You could say a multicolored parrot, the non-appearance of a multicolored parrot right now, here, is not happening right now. That not happening is also right now. Everything that is happening and not happening is equally everywhere right nowness, equally right nowness. Just one moment. So who said that identity is a perception, individual perception? Whoever came up with that notion? Well, we did, Spirit did. But I am everywhere right nowness. everywhere right now, Ness, is the actual fact. So that must be the act. Then there's just one identity. There's just this everywhere nowness identity of everything. Everything. Everything is equally present to right now. Both the manifest and unmanifest. The unmanifest is equally unmanifest. All unmanifest, all manifest is equally manifest to this moment. That's why it's timeless, right? Because both the manifest and unmanifest are equally everywhere nowness, equally present to this moment as they are. Then everything is in this moment. It's all is in this moment. All is one, all is this moment. Everything is present to this moment. Everywhere, right nowness, both manifest and unmanifest. So, the capacity to look at this and just plod along, look at it, is very good. We're going to need this coming up because the fourth dimensional matrix is all about perceptual identity, identifying with form, perception of form as identity. It's just they're changing which forms get worshipped, which forms must you feel are central, you know, the center of identity, and then your distance from them makes you feel less relevant. You see how that works? So if you have royalty, they say, we are, our perception of you is your identity. Okay? And so the closer you are to their perception, you feel the more real that you are, the more present you are. And the farther away you are from the perception, you feel the less real or less present you are to the moment. And so you have this horrible then, desperate attempt to get closer to the royals, to work your way up the royal corporate ladder, to be one of the sycophants, the hangers-ons, the groupies, the entourage of the royals, of whatever there is, to say, yeah, I'm close to them, so I'm more present than those who are farther away. You see how that works? The terrible prison. Even with the great sages and gurus, those who are closer to them think, I'm more real than the ones who are farther away, because in their perception they must be perceiving me. I'm nearer to them, their perception. This is a projection onto the teacher of one's own perceptual identity, a belief in perceptual identity. But to the real teacher, nearness and farness has no relevance whatsoever in terms of identity. Everywhere nowness is the fact, is the felt identity, is the feeling of identity. Identity is a feeling, is the feeling of everywhere now, right nowness. So the fourth dimensional is a situation where you get those who feel more entitled here in the world, who say that their perception is central. And your relationship to their perception is what gives you your feeling of identity. You see that? And that's the ball game that's been going on and goes on and on and on and on in this perceptual madness, perceptual identity madness. And there is just a new spin, meet the new boss, same as the old boss. In other words, in their eyes, what are you in their eyes, you know, in their perception? That's where everybody is going right now. That's what we call progressivism, where we're progressing towards a new set of whose eyes are the central eyes, and how important are we in their eyes, how close are we to them in their eyes, so we have some kind of life relative to their perception of us. You see, this relativism is what's so terrible. And so all of us want to be royals ourselves. We say, I want to be central. You know, I don't want to feel this relativism like I have to desperately try and be relevant to some locational of perception, some center of perception for a moment. So you can see why we're in a very desperate time. Because who wants to end up feeling their identity is relative to how simpatico one is with some sort of ruling elite? That's horrible, isn't it? And the problem with the fourth dimensionals is they have a much higher entitlement complex than we're used to. Very much so. They insist that your existence is relative to their perception of you and how well you implement what they tell you to do. And so if you do not implement what they tell you to do, they see you as a non-entity. You don't have an existence. And there's all sorts of sanctions, etc., for those who they see as not relevant to them. They're sanctioned out of existence. So we're used to the third dimensional tyrants. We're not used to the fourth dimensional tyrants, that's for sure. And that's a whole nother, that's a real nasty prison. So it is desperation time. There is no question it's desperation time. And everybody's trying to jostle to say whose perception is important, and then others are just simply relevant to that perception. Their existence is relative to that perception, you see. But with God, with truth, there is no relativism whatsoever. None. Zero. Perfect equality, you see. Perfect equality of presence right now, everywhere right now, and this perfect equality of presence to the moment. There is no center of perception. There is no center of perception. Perception, there's just the pure awareness, the pure spaciousness, everything equally present to that moment, the manifest and the unmanifest. And you see how wonderful that is. It is both the manifest and the unmanifest. So all potential is equally present to each moment. And that fact never changes in the slightest bit. So we have the complete plenum, the infinite riches, each moment, and it's seamless. There's no change in that, so you don't even need to speak of moments, really, except that we're always free to have appearances, manifest or unmanifest, to play with the riches, the infinite riches that is always present, equally present. So our perfect freedom is perfect freedom. We only say, well, moment by each moment, but it's beyond that. It's actually just pure freedom. But we cannot comprehend that from our standpoint yet, so we don't need to worry about it, but it is so. So everything is timeless, isn't it? Because it's both the manifest appearance of everything and also it not having an appearance. All of that is present right now. So everything is present right now. Equally present to the right nowness. Everywhere right nowness. So it's This seems to be answering all the, you know, the great metaphysical questions. It's answering them. So I'm sort of seeing it, coming upon it here, like a landscape that I'm going around a bend in the road, and there's the landscape, and I'm saying, wow, look at this landscape. Wow. Just looking at the landscape here. And saying, should I go into this landscape? So as we look out across this landscape, we just take it in, let the jitters calm down, start to consider it, say, hey, okay, I see this, this is nice, this is great, I like this. Just get used to it. But of course there are going to be some contractions, some jitters, like, wow, the manifest and the unmanifest are all one. You know, it's all one, equally present. Right now, to the moment, equally factually present. The fact of unmanifestness is equally present, isn't it? You can say everything is everywhere, can't you? Because you can say this bottle, the entire everything else that could ever be is not present, as this bottle is equally unmanifest right now, where this bottle is manifest. So you can say everything is everywhere. Always. Always present. Everything is always equally present everywhere. It's just this total oneness. And this has a feeling. This is a feeling. That we could say is happiness. This is what the mystics, this is the ones who experience this. We're just talking, we're seeing the landscape of this, that's all. Knowing it's very important to go into this land, to enter into this landscape, because the fourth dimensionals will demand relativity, relational relativity, that you only exist in relation to them. And how near or far you are to their ideals, their valuing, you see, their perceiving. That's why I have this fanatical political correctness. This is all the desperate posturing by everyone in the world to feel as if they're going to have an existence in relation to these fourth dimensional extraterrestrials, fourth dimensionals. And what kind of existence are they going to have? Relative existence. And so they're desperate to play along, get along, to go along, to get along with what they're being told is this is how these fourth dimensionals, this is what they like. So if you want to exist, if you want to have more of a sense of existence in relative to their perception of you, you'd better adopt all this dogma, all this valuing, politically correct valuing. You see, that's what's going on in the world, actually. Now, these fourth dimensional ETs are so odd, so bizarre, we tend to, the PC people, put a very high emphasis on bowing down and praising the bizarre, the weird, the odd, the deviant, what's that stuff that's just like we would normally say, ah, that's repulsive, I don't like that. They say, oh no, we love this, this is wonderful. So they're toadying up to the fourth dimensional, saying, look, I love how different you are. I love how different you are from me. They're desperate to get it, to have a sense of identity, you see, relative identity. So the fourth dimensionals will say, will look at them and say, oh, I like your values. You can be fairly near to me, and I'll look upon you and see you. And they say, oh, good, I have an existence because you're seeing me. That's why everybody bows and scrapes to the royals, you know, and aristocracy, like, oh, the celebrity. Oh, celebrity culture is a rehearsal for fourth dimensional existence, fourth dimensionals. The whole bizarre fetish of being enamored of all the weird, bizarre, deviant off, you know, all this stuff that's just, you know, fringe, all this fringe stuff, and people are just thinking, oh yeah, this should be mainstream. I love this. Some of the fourth dimensionals are here. We say, oh yeah, you're mainstream with me. You're totally mainstream. This is what I expect. This is what I love. I'm so glad you're here. You know, and people will just be fawning over them, fawning, desperately fawning to maintain some figment of identity. You see. Some figment of identity that in their eyes you exist, you think. So you say, oh yeah, I look in your eyes. Do I see that I exist in your eyes? Oh, I do. Great. Let me fawn over you some more. See, that's the real politic of the world right now. And of course, those who don't fawn over them, the ones who want to fawn over them and seek approval in their eyes, are denouncing, will denounce them in the most strongest terms. Let, you know, this is utterly terrible. Completely, let's have zero tolerance towards all this stuff. Whatever the fourth dimensionals don't like, I have zero tolerance for it. Complete zero tolerance for it. That's it. Off with their heads right now. And then they look in the fourth dimensionals' eyes or perceptual fields. Oh, is that what you want? Is that what you want? Oh, great. I exist in your eyes? Oh, great. You're perceiving me? Oh, that's wonderful. See, God, reality, there's no center of perception. There's no center of perception at all. Everything equally present to the moment, to right now. Everything manifest and unmanifest equally present to right now. So there's no eyes you need to look in to say, do I exist in your eyes? No, there's none of that. See, totally free of that, totally free of that. So I don't have to be a perceiver so that others have an identity in my eyes. You see that? Because we may think that, hey, others only exist in my eyes as a sense, perception gives that sense. And so I need to be fair to everybody. How am I fair to everybody? How do I include everybody? It puts this enormous burden on us, does it? Does it not? Thinking like I may be excluding others, you know, I'm not thinking of everybody all the time. That's gone in everywhere right nowness. There's no need for anyone to be a perceiver. For everything to be equally present everywhere right nowness. No need for any perception at all. Reality doesn't need to be perceived to be what it is. That takes the complete burden off of us, total burden off us. Wow. Whether my eyes are perceiving anything or not makes absolutely no difference to their absolute presence in the moment right now. So this is a gigantic relief. It doesn't matter whether you're present in somebody else's awareness, perception, and doesn't matter if somebody is present in your perception. Both don't matter in the slightest bit. Total, pure equality. Right now. Always. Inescapable. The eternal life of everything, the equal eternal life of everything, of every awareness. Is felt. The vision of oneness. So, we're right on it. But there's not a lot of time, actually, going forward. Have to really step into this landscape right now. Okay, very great. That's it for this video.